بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. So brothers, from last week we left off here where the Shaykh was explaining, gives an example of two types of people. And talking about, you know, about the afterlife, that, you know, and if you remember, we were talking about what the Shaykh mentioned was that there's a purpose to this life. We were created for a purpose, and we discussed that in detail. And then the Shaykh struck two examples for us, two types of people. And he said that the first type of person was the person who followed the deen, acted upon it, obeyed Allah and the Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that was that person. Then the second type of person is the one who did the opposite. So, you know, was a disbeliever, did all kinds of bad things, etc. You can refer back to last week's lesson for more detail on that. So then the Shaykh continues from there and he says, so if we're looking at these two people, do we think that they won't be recompensed with what they did? So the Shaykh says that, of course, Allah will recompense them with what they did. And this is from the wisdom and justice of Allah. Allah's justice and wisdom. And so in the afterlife, you'll get rewarded. So the person who was obedient, who followed Allah's religion and laws and stuck to them and followed them, then that person will be rewarded with Jannah. And the person who turns away from the message, then this person will end up in the fire, the hellfire, and be punished. So then the Shaykh continues and he says, وَلِذَلِكَ جَعَلَ دَارًا أُخْرَى يُجَازَ فِيهَا الْمُحْسِنُ بِإِحْسَانِهِ وَالْمُسِيءُ بِإِسَاءَتِهِ فَتَظْهَرُ فِيهَا ثَمَرَاتُ الْعَمَلِ. So then the Shaykh says, so for that reason, another life or the hereafter was created so that the good doer could be rewarded with what he did, and the evil and the bad doer, the one who did bad, can be recompensed with what he did. And so he says that in the Darul Akhirah, or the afterlife, the hereafter, the person is a place of recompense. And so we see the fruits of the person's action. And likewise, if you remember, in the previous lessons, we talked about that this life that we're here in the dunya, the life of the dunya, is the place for action. So we act here and we do good deeds. You know, you rack up your, let's say, for example's sake, for argument's sake, your bank balance is full of good deeds. And so you go to the hereafter, you know, you be positive, you be rewarded. Likewise, if your bank balance is empty and you're bankrupt, then you're in a bad situation. So the Shaykh continues and he says, فَالدُّنْيَا دَارٌ عَمَلٍ أَوْ دَارُ عَمَلٍ وَأَمَّا الْآخِرَةُ فَهِيَ دَارُ الْجَزَاءِ أَوْ دَارُ جَزَاءٍ إِمَّا جَنَّةٌ وَإِمَّا نَارٌ وَلَمْ يَتْرُكْنَا هَمَلًا كَمَا يَظُنُّ الْمَلَاحِدَةُ وَالدَّهْرِيُونَ. قال تعالى وقالوا ما هي إلا حياتنا الدنيا نموت ونحيا وما يهلكنا إلا الدهر وما لهم بذلك من علم إنهم إلا يظنون. هذه مقالة الملاحدة الذين لا يؤمنون بالبعث والنشور. So then the Shaykh says, like we just mentioned briefly that earlier, that the Shaykh says here that the dunya is for action, for you to carry out deeds. And the hereafter is where you are recompensed with what you did. Either you go to Jannah or you go to the hellfire. Then the Shaykh says that we weren't left without a purpose, just to wander around with no aim or goal. And this is what the atheists, or those who believe in atheism, believe. This is what they believe, that they're just there. There's no purpose, just wander around like a headless chicken, so to speak, because that's essentially what happens. And Allah said in the Quran, which the ayah that we read here is from Suratul Jathiya. So if we go to the translation, I'll pull that up, Suratul Jathiya, verse 24. So if you read verse 24 from this surah, and they say, there is nothing but our life of this world. We die and we live, and nothing destroys us except the time. And they have no knowledge of it. They only conjecture. So that's clear that that's from the Quran. And that's describing the people who are the atheists, you know, the ones who don't believe in Allah. So then we continue, and the Shaykh continues, and then he mentions, وَقَدْ أَنْكَرُ اللَّهُ أَزَّ وَجَلْ عَلَيْهِمْ فَقَالَ أَفَنَجْعَلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ كَالْمُجْرِمِينَ مَا لَكُمْ كَيْفَ تَحْكُمُونَ وقال تعالى أم حسب الذين اجترحوا السيئات أن نجعلهم كالذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات سواء محياهم ومماتهم ساء ما يحكمون. So then the Shaykh says, and then Allah disavowed what they said and countered what they said. So Allah says in some other ayahs which we just read there. So if we pull up the translation of that, the first of which is from Surah Al-Qalam, verse 35 to 36. So let's go to Surah Al-Qalam, verse 35 and 36. Verse 35, shall we then treat the submitting Muslims like the criminals, polytheists and disbelievers, etc.? What is the matter with you? How do you judge? So this is a counter to these atheists who say what they said in what Allah mentioned about them in the previous ayah that we read. Then the next ayah is, we go back to Surah Al-Jathiyah here. So we go back to Surah Al-Jathiyah, and it's verse 21, actually a couple of ayahs before what we already read. Or do those who earn evil deeds think that we shall hold them equal with those who believe in the oneness of Allah, Islamic monotheism, and do righteous good deeds in their present life and after their death? Worst is the judgment that they make. So that's clear for us. Then the Shaykh continues, and he also mentions a few udayah. So he says, وَقَالَ تَعَالَىٰ أَمْ نَجْعَلُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ كَالْمُفْسِدِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَمْ نَجْعَلُ الْمُتَّقِينَ كَالْفُجَّارِ. So that's from Surah Al-Sa'd. So the Shaykh says, فَهَذَا لَا يُمْكِنْ وَلَا يَكُونْ أَبَدًا. So, and then the Shaykh said that this is not possible. So we'll understand that in a minute. So we go to Surah Al-Sa'd. And that was verse 28. If you read verse 28, shall we treat those who believe in the oneness of Allah and do righteous good deeds as mufsidun, those who associate partners in worship with Allah and commit crimes on earth? Or shall we treat the pious ones, the mutakun, as the fujar, criminals, disbelievers and wicked? So that's a rhetorical question. There's, you know, that the answer is already there. It's known. So the Shaykh says, obviously, that is not absolutely not possible. You can't. The people who've done evil will be recompensed with what they did, with what their hands earned, and the people who did good and followed the Deen, followed the message of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, obeyed Allah and the Messenger, and did good, then they will be rewarded with all the good that they did. So then the Shaykh continues and he says, "Lamma kanat al ibadatu la yajuzu an na'khudaha." من استحساننا أو تقليد فلان وإلان من الناس أرسل الله إلينا رسلا تبين لنا كيف نعبده لأن العبادات توقيفية لا يجوز أن يعبد الله بشيء إلا بما شرعه. So then in this paragraph the Shaykh mentions that, so he says when you know worship best way to put this is when worship is basically from Allah's law, So what the Quran says and what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said is that's what tawqifiyah means. So for you to carry out acts of worship, it has to be in accordance and it has to stop with the Quran and stop with the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the ahadith that we have as sahih. That's what tawqifiyah means. So meaning that we have to follow the evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah. That's where it stops. We can't say, obviously listen to somebody else, for example, say, oh look, I had a dream and, for example, and I saw this and I was told to do this and X, Y, and Z and superstitions and all the rest of it. No, we have two sources under the Quran and the Sunnah, and this is where worship comes from. So whatever we are commanded to do is from the Quran and the Sunnah. Whatever we are forbade to do is from the Quran and Sunnah. And that's where it stops. So the Shaykh says it's not from our liking or what we see to our own liking in terms of worship, or blind following a certain person from the people. So then he says that that's why Allah sent to us messengers to clarify to us what worship is and how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so that's clear there. Then the Shaykh continues and he says, فَالْعِبَادَاتُ تَوْقِفِيَّةُ أو فالعبادات توقيفية على ما جاءت به الرسل عليهم الصلاة والسلام فالحكمة من إرسال الرسل أن يبينوا للناس كيف يعبدون ربهم وينهونهم عن الشرك والكفر بالله عز وجل هذه مهمة الرسل عليهم الصلاة والسلام ولهذا يقول عليه الصلاة والسلام من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد فالعبادة توقيفية والبدع مردودة والخرافات مردودة والتقليد الأعمى مرفوض لا تؤخذ العبادات إلا من الشريعة التي جاء بها الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the Shaykh that mentions, he says worship is توقيفية, and we explained that earlier. So توقيفية, the Shaykh says, is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, or even just generally speaking, what the messengers generally, all the messengers came with, they came with that. So the Shaykh says, so the wisdom behind sending of the prophets is that they clarify to the people, to their nations and to the people, how to worship Allah, and they forbade them from committing shirk and kufr with Allah azza wa jal. And he says, this is the importance of the messengers, alayhi salatu wasalam. And for that reason, yaqulu alayhi salatu wasalam. And for that reason, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam said in a hadith that's well known, man amila amalan laysa alayhi amruna fawarat. So whoever does an action that's not from what we've come with, then it's rejected. It goes back to the person who did it. So if it's not from the Quran, it's not from the authentic Sunnah, it's rejected and it goes back to the person who started the action. So the Shaykh says, so therefore this is clear now what tawqifiyah means. And so al-ibadah, worship, is tawqifiyah, meaning in the Arabic here, it just means it stop. I mean, tawqifiyah means stopping. But what does stopping mean? Stopping where? Stopping where the Quran stops. Stopping where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stopped. So we don't go beyond the Quran, or we don't go beyond the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We don't, you know, go beyond them too. And so the Shaykh mentions now the contrast and the opposite to that, which is, he says, al-bid'u or marduda. So he says that bid'ah, religious innovation, is rejected, and superstitions are rejected, and blind following. So there's following, but there's blind following. So the Shaykh mentions here, blind following is rejected. Is not accepted, is rejected. So the worship is not accepted except from the Sharia that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. So that's clear to us all there. Then the Shaykh continues and he says, قَوْلُهُ بَلْ أَرْسَلَ إِلَيْنَا رَسُولًا هُوَ مُحَمَّدٌ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ خَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ أَرْسَلَهُ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَنَا لِمَاذَا أَبْلِكْنَا وَيُبَيِّنُ لَنَا كَيْفَ نَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وينهانا عن الشرك والكفر والمعاصي، هذه مهمة الرسل، مهمة الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم، وقد بلغ البلاغ المبين وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة عليه الصلاة والسلام، وبين ووضح، وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. وهذا كما في قوله تعالى: اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. From Surah Al-Ma'idah. So we'll just break that down here, what the Shaykh is saying. We'll translate it. Then the Shaykh says, and his speech, بَلْ أَرْسَلَ إِلَيْنَا رَسُولًا. Rather, a messenger was sent to us, and that he sent to us a messenger. And the Shaykh says, he is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that was sent to us. خَاتُمَ النَّبِيِّينَ. The seal of the prophets, the final prophet and messenger. Nobody will know, or the prophet messenger will come after him. That's it. That's the message for specifically that he came to his tribe, his people, and generally to everybody else, because there's nobody, there won't be a messenger that will come after him, a new messenger, none. So then the Shaykh says, why? And he was sent to clarify to us why we were created, what's our goal in life, what's our purpose in life. And the Shaykh says here, he says, and to clarify to us how to worship Allah, how we worship Allah Azza wa Jal, and how to stay away from shirk and disbelief and disobedience. This was the importance of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam being sent. And so the Shaykh mentions here that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has conveyed a clear message. He's conveyed it clearly. The message is clear, and he has carried out his duty of trust. The trust, what Allah entrusted him upon, he completed that, and he advised the Ummah, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he clarified to us the deen of Allah, and he left us upon a clear white path, so to speak, a clear white path. It's night, is like it's day. So just how we know it's night now in the UK, for example, we can see, you know, it's dark, it's night time. Just like we can differentiate from the night and the day. That's exactly how the deen is. It's clear. It's absolutely clear. And then the Shaykh mentions here, and this is obviously from a hadith as well, what the Shaykh has mentioned here, is that nobody deviates from this clear path except he's destroyed. And then the Shaykh continues and says, and this is as what we've just read here is like from the speech of Allah, which we just read as the ayah from Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse 3, Al-Yawma Akmaltu Lakum Deenakum. So if we look at the translation of that, and we just go to the translation and have a look, we will see what's intended here. So it's a long ayah, so let's go to the bit where we need to be to. So the Shaykh quoted the ayah, and the translation of that, the end part of the ayah, the third ayah of Surah Al-Ma'idah, is, this day those who disbelieved have given up all hope, so fear not them, but fear me. This day I have perfected your religion for you, completed my favor upon you, and have chosen for you Islam as your religion. But as for him who is forced by severe hunger with no inclination to sin, such can eat those above mentioned meats. So you can refer back to the whole ayah itself, but the bit we need to focus on here is, this day I have perfected your religion for you, completed my favor upon you, and I've chosen for you Islam as your religion. So that's what the Shaykh has quoted for us here in the Arabic. So we continue. And the Shaykh says, قَوْلُهُ مَنْ أَطَاعَهُ أَيْ فِي مَا أَمَرَ بِهِ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. So then the Shaykh says, and his speech, he says, Man ata'ahu, whoever is obedient to him, and whoever obeys him, i.e. in that which he has commanded, then he'll enter Jannah. Wa qawluhu wa man asahu ay fi ma nahanhu dakhla an-nar. And then also, and his speech, and whoever is disobedient to him, i.e. in that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade us from, then he'll enter the hellfire. And so the Shaykh says, he says, وَهَذَا مِصْدَاقُهُ كَثِيرٌ فِي الْقُرْآنِ قَالَ تَعَالَى من يطع الرسول فقد أطاع الله. النساء. وقال تعالى: وما أرسلنا من رسول إلا ليطاع بإذن الله. النساء verse 64. وقال سبحانه: وإن تطيعوه تهتدوا. سورة النور verse 54. وقال تعالى: وأطيعوا الرسول لعلكم ترحمون. سورة النور verse 56. فمن أطاعه اهتدى ودخل الجنة، ومن عصاه ضل ودخل النار. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم: كلكم يدخل الجنة إلا من أبى. قالوا: يا رسول الله، ومن يأبى؟ قال: من أطاعني دخل الجنة، ومن عصاني فقد أبى. So there's quite a lot of ayahs there. So let's just go through this bit by bit. So the Shaykh says that the examples are many in the Quran with what we're discussing. So he gives us a few anyway. So we'll take them. So we'll just go through the ayahs that we read. So the first ayah is from Surah An-Nisa, verse 80. So this one's, whoever obeys the Prophet, for indeed he has obeyed Allah. So whoever obeys the Prophet has obeyed Allah. And then the next ayah is from Surah An-Nisa, verse 64. So if you go there quickly, verse 64, and read that. We sent no messenger but to be obeyed by Allah's leave. If they, hypocrites, when they had been unjust to themselves, had come to you, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and begged Allah's forgiveness, and the messenger had begged forgiveness for them, indeed they would have found Allah all-forgiving, one who accepts repentance, most merciful. So that's the whole ayah. We get the context. Then the next ayah is from Surah An-Nur, verse 54. So Surah An-Nur, verse 54. You read the whole ayah. Say, obey Allah and obey the messenger. But if you turn away, he, the messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is only responsible for the duty placed on him, i.e. to convey Allah's message, and you for that placed on you. If you obey him, you shall be on the right guidance. The messenger's duty is only to convey the message in a clear way, i.e. to preach in a plain way. So the bit where the Shaykh quoted was this bit here: if you obey him, you shall be on the right guidance. And then the next ayah is from Surah An-Nur. So we're going back to Surah An-Nur. So we go back to Surah An-Nur, verse 56. We should read that as well. And perform as-salat, iqamat as-salat, and give zakat, obey the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you may receive mercy. So there we are again, clear ayahs from the Quran for anybody to understand that obeying the messenger is important, and whoever obeys the messenger, then therefore he's obeyed Allah. So then the Shaykh says, so whoever obeys him has been guided and will enter Jannah, and whoever disobeys him, then he's misguided and he will enter the fire. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, all of you will enter Jannah except the one who rejects or turns away. So some of the Sahaba said, O Rasulullah, and who is the one who rejects or turns away? He said, whoever obeys me will enter Jannah, and whoever disobeys me, for indeed he has turned away and rejected the message. And then the Shaykh continues, so he says, فَقَوْلُهُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَبَى أَيْ أَبَى أَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةِ وَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لَا يَسْمَعُ بِي يَهُودِي وَلَا نَصْرَانِي ثُمَّ لَا يُؤْمِنُ بِالَّذِي جِئْتُ بِهِ إِلَّا دَخَلَ النَّارِ فَمَنْ أَطَاهُ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَنْ أَصَاهُ دَخَلَ النَّارِ وَهَذَا هُوَ الْفَارِقُ بَيْنَ الْمُؤْمِنِ وَالْكُفَّارِ. So then the Shaykh says, what does the word in Arabic Aba mean? Aba. And he says, I, one who has been, so the word from this hadith, what it means. So he says that one who's basically rejected from Jannah, he won't enter Jannah. And the Prophet ﷺ said, if a Yahudi or a Nasrani, so a Jew, or a Christian, in terms of this example, a Christian or a Jew who hears of me, then does not believe with that which I came with, if he's in that state, then he will enter the fire. So obviously following the messenger, obviously following the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that's how we will get to paradise. And so that's an example, for example, a Christian and a Jew, for example, in this. And it could be any, it's anybody as well. This is a specific example, but also anybody who hears of the Prophet and then rejects the message, then that's his, that will be the ending. He'll end up in the fire because he's turned away from the message for whatever reason that is. So then the Shaykh mentions, says, وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, what's the evidence of what we're talking about right now? And the Shaykh mentions the ayah. So he says, إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ رَسُولًا شَاهِدًا عَلَيْكُمْ كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَى فِرْعَوْنَ رَسُولًا فَعَصَى فِرْعَوْنُ الرَّسُولَ فَأَخَذْنَاهُ أَخْذًا وَبِيلًا. And that's from Surah Al-Muzammil, verse 15 to 16. So let's get the translation of that as well. Surah Al-Muzammil, verse 15 and 16. Verily we have sent to you, O men, a messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to be a witness over you, as we did send a messenger, Musa, Moses, to Fir'aun, Pharaoh. But Fir'aun, Pharaoh, disobeyed the messenger, Musa, Moses, so we seized him with a severe punishment. So you continue. So the Shaykh continues to mention some more ayahs. He says, قَوْلُهُ وَالدَّلِيلُ أَيْ عَلَىٰ إِرْسَالِ الرَّسُولِ الرَّسُولِ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَىٰ إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ رَسُولًا شَاهِدًا عَلَيْكُمْ كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَىٰ فِرْعَوْنَ رَسُولًا فَعَصَى فِرْعَوْنُ الرَّسُولَ فَأَخَذْنَاهُ أَخْذًا وَبِيلًا, which we already read. And this is the evidence of sending the messengers. So this is the evidence of why the messengers were sent, why they sent. قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَىٰ إِنَّا. So the Shaykh is going to explain the ayah here for us. So I'll do my best. There's some grammar in here. Inna al-dhamir raji' ila Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa hadha dhamir al-mu'azzam nafsu li'annahu azeemun subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Shaykh says, inna, at the start of this, if you can see, at the start of the ayah, Allah says, inna, we. Indeed, we, verily we. And in the Quran, we see this a lot. We or us. And it doesn't mean multiple people. In Arabic language, I just want to clarify, in the Arabic language, it's to raise, when you say like that, when you, for example, if you said it, if we said we, if I was talking to you now and I said we or us, I'm raising myself, I'm magnifying myself. I'm raising my status and I'm magnifying myself. And this is what that means here. It doesn't mean that there's multiple people talking. No. So the Shaykh mentions here, and he says that this is a noun or a pronoun that's going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's to Allah's magnifying himself. And then the Shaykh says, arsalna. So in the ayah, if we go back, inna arsalna. So arsalna, we sent. Kadhalika hadha damirul idma or idma or idma wa ma'na arsalna. بَعَثْنَاهُ وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِ. So again, similar, أَرْسَلْنَا, use it saying us, or we have sent. So again, this is to magnify. Allah's magnifying himself. And obviously we sent, meaning that we had sent the messenger on a mission with a message. And we have revealed, for example, the Quran, we have revelation has been sent to him. إليكم, to you. So إليكم, to you. يا معشر الثقلين الجن والإنس خطاب لجميع الناس لأن رسالة هذا الرسول عامة لجميع الناس إلى أن تقوم ساعة. So إليكم, in the plural, to you, all of you, to all of the jinn and all of humankind. A message to everybody. Because the message of this messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is for all of the creation, the jinn and the mankind, up until the hour is established, the day of judgment. Rasulan, what does Rasulan mean here? Rasulan, and who is this Rasul, who is this messenger? It's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Shahidan alaykum, testifying upon you, witness against you, upon you, a witness upon you. And the Shaykh says, أي عند الله سبحانه وتعالى يوم القيامة بأنه بلغكم رسالة الله وأقام الحجة عليكم كما قال تعالى رسلا مبشرين ومنذرين لأن لا يكون للناس على الله حجة بعد الرسل فلا أحد يوم القيامة يقول أنا لم أدري أني مخلوق للعبادة أنا لم أدري ماذا يجب علي ولم أدري ماذا يحرم علي لا يمكن أن يقول هذا لأن الرسل عليهم الصلاة والسلام قد بلغتهم وهذه الأمة المحمدية تشهد عليهم قال تعالى وكذلك جعلناكم أمة وسطا لتكونوا شهداء على الناس ويكون الرسول عليكم شهيدا. So we'll just stop there at that end of that paragraph. So the Shaykh says, a witness upon you, meaning he says, a witness with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. That because the message had been sent, the message had been conveyed, that the mission that Allah had sent the Prophet on, he completed it. The message was conveyed. And therefore, the evidence or the proof has been established upon you, meaning upon us, upon the jinn, all of the jinn and upon mankind. And then the Shaykh says, as Allah said in the Quran, and we read the ayahs here, so Surah An-Nisa, verse 165. So if we go to verse 165, so let's read that. So we'll just go a little bit back to the verse 164 towards the end of it. So, yeah, okay, just one second. We'll start from verse 165. Messengers as bearers of good news as well as of warning in order that mankind should have no plea against Allah after the messengers. And Allah is ever all-powerful, all-wise. So you can see that once the message has been conveyed and the people have been warned and the good news has come to them and they also have been warned if they don't follow it, then that's the proof that has been established upon them, so that they, and then if we just go back and read this again, in order that mankind should have no plea against Allah after the messengers. So that's clear to us. So then the Shaykh says, so nobody on the day of judgment can say, oh, I don't know, I didn't know that I was created to worship Allah. Oh, I didn't know what was obligatory upon me. Oh, I didn't know what was made haram upon me, so I stay away from it. For example, the Shaykh says this is not possible that one says this, or a person like that, he says this, because the messengers alayhim wassalatu wassalam, they had reached them and they had conveyed the message. And this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a witness and will testify on all of them and the previous nations as well. And then we mentioned an ayah here. The Shaykh mentions an ayah, so we read it as well. And that's from Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 143. So if we go to verse 143, and we'll go to the bit where the Shaykh had quoted from this long ayah. So we'll go here. So it says, thus we have made you true Muslims, real believers of Islamic monotheism, true followers of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his sunnah, legal ways. Wasat, meaning a just and the best nation, that you be witnesses over mankind, and the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam be a witness over you. So that's what the Shaykh quoted here. And we'll continue now to the next paragraph. فَهَذِي الْأُمَّةُ تَشْهَدُ عَلَى الْأُمَّمِ السَّابِقَةِ يوم القيامة أن رسلها بلغتها رسالات الله أو رسالات الله بما يجدونه من كتاب الله عز وجل لأن الله قص علينا نبأ الأمم السابقة والرسل وما قالوه لأممهم كل هذا عرفناه من كتاب الله عز وجل الذي لا يأتيه الباطل من بين يديه ولا من خلفه تنزيل من حكيم حميد. So then the Shaykh says here, what we just briefly mentioned in the previous paragraph when we were translating it, that says these nations, will bear witness that the messengers came to them on the Yawm al-Qiyamah. The nation of the Prophet, our Ummah, will bear witness upon them that the message reached all of them, all of these people. The message had reached them. It got to them. Why would you say, what's the proof of that? Is from what we find from the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. What's mentioned, what Allah has mentioned from the stories and what's been narrated from there regarding the other nations, previous nations, and the messengers that were sent to them, etc. So all of this we have learned or become aware of and know from the book of Allah Azza wa Jal, which contains no falsehood from behind it or from in front of it. It contains nothing. And it's that which is revealed from the heavens, right? From the all wise and the one deserved of all praise. So the Shaykh continues and he says, وَيَكُونُ الرَّسُولُ وَهُوَ مُحَمَّدٌ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ عَلَيْكُمْ يَا أُمَّةَ مُحَمَّدٍ شَهِيدًا يَشْهَدُ عَلَيْكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَنَّهُ أَقَامَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْحُجَّةِ وَبَلَّغَكُمُ الرِّسَالَةِ وَنَسَحَكُمْ فِي اللَّهِ فَلَا حُجَّةَ لِأَحَدٍ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ بِأَنْ يَقُولَ مَا بَلَغَنِي شَيْءٍ ما جاءني من نذير حتى الكفار يعترفون عندما يلقون في النار قال تعالى كلما ألقي فيها فوج سألهم خزنتها ألم يأتكم نذير قالوا بلى قد جاءنا نذير فكذبنا وقلنا ما نزل الله من شيء إن أنتم إلا في ضلال كبير يقولون للرسل أنتم في ضلال فهم يكذبون الرسل ويضللونهم. So the Shaykh just mentioned here, he says ويكون الرسول, and it says that means Muhammad, and it's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who's been sent, who's upon us, he's a witness upon us, it's the messenger who's a witness upon us, and he says here, O Ummah of Muhammad, that the Prophet Muhammad is a witness upon us. He's going to be a witness upon us with Allah on the Day of Judgment. And this is the proof that's against, either it'll be against us or for us. If we follow the message, it's for us. If we turn away from the message and reject it, it's against us. And the proof has been established. And the message has come to all of us. And the Prophet ﷺ has advised us sincerely, and therefore there won't be a proof for us on that day for anybody on Yawm al-Qiyamah, on the Day of Judgment, that we say, for example, the likes of, oh, nothing came to me, I didn't get the message, or was nothing, nobody came to me, nothing came to me of a warning. Even the kuffar, they will admit, when they are thrown in the fire, they will admit this as well, that they will admit themselves that they rejected the message. So we'll read the ayah that we read from Surah Mulk. Look, even up to the kuffar. So if you go to Surah Mulk, verse 8 and 9. It almost bursts up with fury every time a group is cast therein. Its keeper will ask, did no warner come to you? This is the hellfire now. They will say, yes, indeed, a warner did come to us, but we belied him and said, Allah never sent down anything of revelation. You are only in great error. And if you continue to the next ayah, let's just read the next ayah. And they will say, had we but listened or used our intelligence, we would not have been among the dwellers of the blazing fire. So then the Shaykh says, So if we take that ayah there, then the Shaykh mentions as well, he says that the kuffar, they'll be saying, we said that they're liars, the messengers are liars, they've got no evidence, they've got nothing, and we rejected them. And then the Shaykh continues and he says, هذه الحكمة في إرسال الرسل إقامة الحجة على العباد وهداية من أراد الله هدايته أو هدايته الرسل يهديه الله بهم من من يشاء ويقيم الحجة أو ويقيم الحجة على من عاند وجحد وكفر. So then the Shaykh says, he says, this is the wisdom. This is the wisdom in sending the messengers to establish the proof upon the slaves and the servants of Allah and guidance for those who Allah wishes guidance for. The messengers, you know, guide the person, are guided. The messengers guide and call to the truth and guide people to Allah. And also that Allah guides through the messengers whoever he wills. Whoever he wills, Allah guides whoever he wills through the messengers, through their message. And he establishes the proof upon the one who is stubborn and rejects and disavows and disbelieves in the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the Shaykh continues and says, كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَى فِرْعَوْنَ رَسُولًا. So we're going back to the original ayah where now Allah mentions how we sent to Fir'aun a messenger. And then the Shaykh says, الرَّسُولُ هُوَ مُوسَى عَلَيْهِ سَلَاتُ وَالسَّلَامُ وَفِرْعَوْنُ هُوَ الْمَلِكُ الْجَبَّارُ فِي مِصْرَ الَّذِي إِدَّعَ الرَّبُوبِيَّةِ وَفِرْعَوْنُ لقب أو لقب لكل من لكل من ملك مصر أو ملك مصر قالوا له فرعون المراد به هنا فرعون الذي ادعى الربوبية فقال أنا ربكم الأعلى. So the Shaykh then he mentions the ayah from the ayah that we mentioned earlier like we sent to فرعون a messenger. The Shaykh says the messenger being mentioned here is Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And Fir'aun, Pharaoh, is that Pharaoh who was a arrogant ruler of Misr, who claimed lordship. And he says the Shaykh mentions another benefit for us. He says Fir'aun, Pharaoh. Every leader of Misr, every leader of Misr was given the name Fir'aun. However, the one we're talking about here, the purpose of the Fir'aun that's been mentioned here by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, is the Fir'aun who basically said that he was Allah, and he was Allah, he was the Lord. And then the Shaykh mentions ayah from Surah An-Naziat, فَقَالَ أَنَا رَبُّكُمْ وَلَعَلَىٰ I'm your Lord, the Most High. He said this. So this is what he said from his arrogance, even though he knew he wasn't. And the Shaykh continues says, فَعَسَى فِرْعَوْنَ الرَّسُولُ هُوَ مُوسَى كَفَرَ بِهِ فِرْعَوْنَ كَمَا قَصَّ اللَّهُ فِي كِتَابِهِ مَا جَرَى بَيْنَ مُوسَى وَفِرْعَوْنَ وَمَا انْتَهَى إِلَيْهِ أَمْرُ فِرْعَوْنَ وَقَوْمُهُ أمر فرعون وقومه. Then the Shaykh mentions the other part. He says, "فَسَأَ فِرْعَوْنَ الرَّسُولَ." So, Fir'aun, this Fir'aun, he disobeyed Musa alayhi salam, the message that he came with, and he disbelieved in that, as we know from the Quran what Allah has told us about this particular occurrence, and what happened between Musa alayhi salam and Fir'aun, and what the ending was of Fir'aun and the people when they were drowned. And then the Shaykh mentions the next part of the ayah that we mentioned towards the start of the lesson, فَأَخَذْنَاهُ. So we took him, or we seized him, or we took him. So i.e. أَخَذْنَا فِرْعَوْنُ بِالْعُقُوبَةِ وَهُوَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ أَغْرَقَهُ هُوَ وَقَوْمُهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ ثُمَّ أَدْخَلَهُمُ النَّارِ مِمَّا خَطِيَاتِهِمْ أُغْرِقُوا فَأُدْخِلُوا نَارًا فصار في النار في البرزخ قال تعالى النار يعرضون عليها غدوا وعشيا، هذا في البرزخ قبل الآخرة، يعرضون على النار صباحا ومساء إلى أن تقوم الساعة، وهذا دليل على عذاب القبر والعياذ بالله. ويوم تقوم الساعة أدخلوا آل فرعون أشد العذاب. So we'll just stop there for a second. So the Shaykh says, فَأَخَذْنَاهُ. So from a quoting from the speech of Allah, and we took him, meaning we took Fir'aun, or we seized him with punishment. And it is that Allah drowned him and his people who followed him in the sea, then lent to them into hellfire. So we read a couple of ayahs there. So we go to the first one, Surah An-Nuh, verse 25. So let's go to verse 25, Surah An-Nuh, verse 25. Because of their sins, they were drowned, then were made to enter the fire, and they found none to help them instead of Allah. So then the Shaykh mentions that ayah and says, and he says, so their affair became the fire in the barzakh. So barzakh is the life of the grave. So obviously up until the hour is established, then the dunya will end and the life after death will start. But between that time, when people pass away, then they're in barzakh. So they are in the life of the grave, the death. So this person, so Fir'aun and his people, they've got the reward of the fire, the recompense of the fire in their grave, that they will be punished. So the ayah is from Surah Ghafir, verse 46. So let's go there. Surah Ghafir, verse 46. If you read that, the fire, they are exposed to it morning and afternoon. And on the day when the hour will be established, it will be said to the angels, cause Fir'aun's people to enter the severest torment. So that's quite clear for us as well from what we read. So the Shaykh says this is the barzakh, the life of the grave, before the life after death. Yeah, so he says here that they will be punished with the fire day and evening, or day and afternoon, day and evening, night and day, up until the hour is established. And this is the evidence for the punishment of the grave. So this is the evidence also for the punishment of the grave, or in the grave. When we enter the grave, there'll be a punishment of the grave. It's specific to the grave. And we seek refuge in Allah from that. Then the next ayah that we also mentioned was from Surah Al-Ghafir, verse 46. We read that, and there was also same ayah mentioned again. So we'll just read that for a reminder for us. The fire, they are exposed to it in morning and afternoon, and on the day when the hour will be established, it will be said to the angels, cause Pharaoh's people to enter the severest torment on the day of judgment. So then the Shaykh, we've almost finished now, we're getting towards the end here. So the Shaykh mentions extra benefits here, mentions three benefits for us, and it's to do with the punishment, with three types of punishment. He says here, هذه ثلاثة عقوبات الأولى أن الله أغرقهم ومحاهم عن أخراهم في لحظة واحدة الثانية أنهم يُعذبون في البرزخ إلى أن تقوم الساعة الثالثة أنهم إذا بعثوا يوم القيامة يدخلون أشد العذاب والعياذ بالله وكذلك من عصى محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم فإن مآله أشد من مآل قوم فرعون لأن محمدا هو أفضل الرسل فمن عصاه تكون عقوبته أشد. So the Shaykh mentions, he says, there's three punishments for him was mentioned here, and he breaks these punishments down for us. This is the first one, is that Allah drowned them. So to talk about the Pharaoh's people and Pharaoh, the Pharaoh, drowned them and prevented them, right, from surviving. So drowned them, and they were punished by drowning in an instant. The second one is that they will be punished in the barzakh, in the life of the grave. They were going to be punished up until the hour is established. And thirdly, that when they will be raised on the day of judgment, when they will be resurrected on the day of judgment, they will enter the severest punishment when we seek refuge from that. We seek refuge in Allah from that. So these are three punishments for these, for those people and Fir'aun. And the Shaykh says, and like that, whoever disobeys Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so his affair is severe. His issue is going to be even severe than that of Fir'aun and his people, or that of Fir'aun, because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is the best of messengers. So whoever disobeys him, the best of messengers, whoever disobeys the best of messengers, i.e. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then his punishment is going to be severe, even severe than we've already mentioned. So then the Shaykh mentions the next part of this ayah that we were reading, and he was explaining to us. Akhdhan wabila. So this is the very last part. Akhdhan wabila. Ay shadidan qawiyan la hawadata fi. وكذلك أخذ ربك إذا أخذ القرى وهي ظالمة إن أخذه أليم شديد. So we'll just explain that, we finished the lesson, alhamdulillah. So if we go to Surah Hud, verse 102. Let's read that, verse 102. Such is the seizure of your Lord when he seizes the population of towns while they are doing wrong. Verily, his seizure is painful and severe. So then, the Shaykh mentions that ayah to us, and he also says that akhdhan wabila, therefore, means a severe punishment, taken severely, and they will be punished severely in a strong way. And you can imagine a strong and severe and painful punishment. No escape from it. And then the ayah explains that as well for us. So we'll stop there. Alhamdulillah, we've reached this chapter here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala la yarda an yushraka ma'ahu fi ibadati ahad. So this chapter, which we'll start from next week, inshallah, is we'll go through that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not pleased with the one who shares his worship, associates his worship with other than Allah. And obviously that's shirk, as we know from previous books that we studied, that there's a definition of shirk. And whoever commits it and does not commit shirk ul akbar, which this is mentioning here, then if he does not seek forgiveness before he dies, then he enters the hellfire. And that's the one sin that Allah will not accept. And we'll go through that in more detail. The shirk will explain to us next week, inshallah. So we'll finish there. Jazakallah khair. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته